There's a Buddhist stupa on a hill overlooking the Hungarian village of Tar. This village is home to less than 2,000 people and is an enjoyable 2-hour train ride from Budapest. As you approach the Slovakian border, you start to see the Carpathian Mountains erupting out of an otherwise flat country. In a walk out of the town and across the highways, this towering stupa, which is a sacral building in Buddhism that usually houses relics or can be used for meditation. The stupa is flanked by several pavilions, and nearby is a temple, a great sign that reads Buddha Park, and a combination tea house and gift shop, of course, where you can pick up jewelry, desk ornaments, books, medicinal products, and exotic teas. The centerpiece of the campus is definitely its white and gold stupa, complete with rotating prayer wheels, Tibetan art, ample pictures of the Dalai Lama. Crucially, this stupa and some of the rest of the campus's buildings hold etchings, memorials, artifacts, and placards regarding the man for whom this park honors. Considered the founder of Tibetology, Sándor Kodosi Csoma was a Hungarian linguist who traveled to the Himalayas in the early 1800s. This ethnic Hungarian Sike from Transylvania was called in his lifetime the foreign pupil by the Tibetan monks who knew him, mastered the Tibetan language, and wrote the first Tibetan-to-English dictionary. Kodosi Csoma is considered the first European traveler to visit the Zanskar Valley and read the two great encyclopedias of Tibetan Buddhist literature, a collective of 324 volumes. Csoma died of malaria in Darjeeling in 1842, preparing for a return trip to the monasteries of Tibet, but his writing and legacy have long endured no more vividly than here in this Buddha park overlooking this village in northern Hungary. In 1933, a delegation from the Empire of Japan visited the Kingdom of Hungary and posthumously declared Kodosi Csoma as a bodhisattva, either a student or a saint in Buddhism, depending on who you're talking to. And in 1992, Tenzin Gyatso, the 14th Dalai Lama himself, the main guy we think of when we think of the Dalai Lama, visited Hungary to inaugurate this very park. Already an unusual sight in rural Hungary, there's more to this place than meets the eye. Scattered throughout its campus are small pavilions. Just to the left of the central stupa, housing one really big prayer wheel you can walk around while you meditate, always clockwise, is statues of the Buddha, offering platters, and some of Kodosi Choma's artifacts, you'll find another even larger building, basically a museum. This museum houses an exhibit called Scythians and Huns on the Ancient Path of the Buddhas. Inside, there's a statue of and several placards describing Milarepa, one of the most famous yogis and poets in Tibetan Buddhism and the spiritual forefather of the group that erected the park. But if you read the Hungarian text in here, you'll notice the wall-to-wall posters and pictures containing rhetoric that I don't think you'll find in your typical Buddhist temple. There are maps, photos, and paragraphs of writing emphasizing the genealogical and cultural relationship that the countries of Tibet and Hungary share. Amidst maps showing the many people descended from a multi-continental Hun Empire reads signage suggesting that Tibetans are the custodians of the ancient Scythian Hun traditions. There's writing that the sister of the ancient Hungarian spiritual tradition is Tibetan Buddhism, that Tibetan researchers themselves say Tibetans descended from the eastern branch of the Huns, that the Scythian Hun peoples and their ancient practices played a fundamental and decisive role in the development of Buddhism. You can learn, too, that the traditions of both the Hungarian pre-Christian faith and the Tibetan inner path are rooted in this prehistoric Hun religion. Claims are made that the Buddha's tribe was actually a Scythian tribe related to the ancestors of the Hungarian people, and the exhibit regularly refers to the Buddha Siddhartha Gautama himself as a Scythian sage. There are maps and genealogical charts indicating the continuity of the ancient Hunnic society and Buddhist practices now. There are paragraphs and quotations from Chinese historians as well, underscoring that Hungarians are descendants of the Huns, for whom the Great Wall was built to keep away. Finally, at the end of the pavilion's exhibit is a wall that presents Hungarian folk costumes, embroidery, and art as having eerie parallels with the art of Tibetan Buddhist culture. You'll find one text from a Hungarian priest conveying his theory that Jesus Christ himself evaporated in a miraculous flash of rainbow light, and according to the author, this means the Messiah reached the Buddhist nirvana, synthesizing these Christian and Buddhist religions. It's also implied that the wigwams, or the teepees of Native American societies, have surprising similarities to the yurts that steppe peoples and the ancient Hungarians called home. Although it's not explicitly said, the maps showing this great civilizational continuity of an enlightened culture across Eurasia, the Tibetans and Hungarians, the indigenous peoples of North and South America, and a lot of other groups descend from, is a map of a place that's been called Turin. Together, I think we can explore it. Welcome to Season 1, Episode 1 of the Turin Explorer podcast, a show about Hungary and the centuries-old question of who are the Hungarians. I'm your host, Turin Explorer, and today I want to let you know why we're here and why I think the history of a nationalist, Orientalist ideology that I'll be broadly calling Hungarian Turinism is interesting and important, no matter who you are. I also want to read to you from the Persian Book of Kings, because I think it's cool. The word Turanism means a lot of things in a lot of different places, but in Hungary, it is a modern, romantic, aesthetic, and social movement to turn away from the West and Europe, either politically, culturally, and spiritually, and turn toward, well, the East, but more so an imagined version of the East and a mythic past and destiny for the Hungarian nation. Some of the arguments that I described in the Kuroshi Choma Pavilion are not unique to this Buddha park. There has been a continuous search to uncover the true ancient ancestors or linguistic and cultural kin of the Hungarians throughout nearly all of Hungarian history. It was an obsession in the 19th and 20th centuries, but it even drove medieval Hungarians to unfathomable extremes. It is in search for Hungarian ancestors that Kuroshi Choma himself sent out to Tibet in the first place. It's because of that search that he founded the field of Western Tibetology. He didn't find any evidence of those ancestors, which he actually believed were a people called the Yellow Uyghurs, which we'll get into later in the series, but while there are some truly interesting anthropological connections about the civilization from whence the early Hungarians came and Tibetan culture, the kind of direct and fundamental connections made in the Tar pavilions are pretty much only made by the most esoteric fringes of Hungarian intelligentsia and very few academics from outside of Hungary. Like Kuroshi Choma, there have been dozens of Hungarian explorers and theorists who have set out on incredible journeys, mastering dozens of languages, traveling incognito, converting religions, and at times operating under the payroll of clandestine powers. Their journeys took them to Tibet, Afghanistan, Africa, Siberia, Japan, Ecuador, Argentina. Modern era, they've taken some curious explorers to Atlantis or outer space. These figures are fascinating and complicated. Some of them I've learned enough about to say were obviously evil. Some I poke fun at and find endearing. Some I think were genuinely good, but probably wrong about a lot of stuff. While many, if not most of them, failed to ever prove or generate any real credibility for their theories of kinship and ancestry, they yielded globally important contributions to culture and science. They lived unfathomable lives, many of them, teeming with enlightenment, heartbreak, petty disputes, and international conflict. By looking at their lives and the search for the meaning and identity of the Hungarian people, I think we can both see the whole of Hungarian history and what I think is an important case study for anyone interested in topics like race, language, politics, trauma, the occult, power, crime, class, religion, and so much more. These are the stories I want to explore with you. It's really my goal, whether you're a Hungarian historian or cannot locate the country on a map, I think this podcast will have something you can find interesting. But if you have any recommendations, email me at turanexplorer@gmail.com or follow me on Twitter or TikTok. A lot of this history is guys getting pissed at each other over grammar, but within this history await the medieval friar who was the first in his world to encounter the Mongols, a celebrity globetrotter named in the novel Dracula, whose son's godfather was King Edward VII, headlines about a ritual cult sacrifice, a European haji, a close friend of the Saudi royal family, conspiracy theorists, blood pacts, New Age ancient alien cults, the 21st century rise of European ethno-nationalism, the Hungarian women's liberation movement, both Jews and fascists, and even spies, sometimes triple agents. These figures, their endeavors, and their history made an impact far outside the realm of Hungarian statecraft and culture, influencing the politics and intelligentsia of Turkey, Great Britain, Russia, Israel, Japan, Argentina, and North America, to name only a few. And this isn't just ancient history, too. If you've heard about Hungary in the news, you've probably known that there's a lot of attention placed on the extreme Hungarian nationalist movement today. Well, really in all of Central and Eastern Europe, but Hungary, with its particular history and geography, definitely has a special flavor to it. I don't think it's a stretch to say the dynamic of the Hungarian right wing today has a polarity not dissimilar to the poles the country's right wing had 100 years ago, when Hungarian Turanism was at its height. For example, there's a dominant and institutional Christian conservative mainstream that faces toward the West, at least symbolically. And this mainstream conservatism is not unlike other European conservative movements. And then there's a neo-pagan, ultra-nationalist, ethnocentrist, and occult movement that you could sort of say faces toward the East, but again, this is an imagined and orientalized East. These are by no means mutually exclusive, but they are two poles, and they play this game with one another, just like they did during the interwar. At times, the institutionalized conservatism of someone like Viktor Orbán entertains the Eastern-facing ultranationalism and lends institutional credibility and victories to it. But at other times, it keeps a safe distance from those most alienating and occult impulses. You've still got to get the nannies, aunties, and grandmas to vote for you. Sometimes, as we'll see, the country's ideologues or politicians will entertain the idea of Hungarians being an Eastern people through things like observer membership on the Turkic Council, rhetoric at events that Hungarians are split between Asia and Europe, even jokes that ancient Hungarians influenced the creation of K-pop. But then you'll also see these same politicians decrying plots to create a mixed-race society or praising the whiteness of Argentina's soccer team. I'll leave it at that for now. All I want to say about the present day is that this ideology does impact Hungarian politics, but I also don't want to overemphasize its role in something like Hungarian foreign or domestic policy, too, either in the present day or pre-war. And it's not just political manifestations as well. The thing that I'm going to describe in broad strokes as Hungarian Turanism and tendencies of Hungarian nationalist orientalism that accompany it probably constitute an artistic movement, even more so than it does a political one. From the 19th century onward, many Hungarian visual and literary artists pulled from this theme to create new and, I'd say, genuinely innovative or provocative Hungarian styles. This persisted through the 20th century and continues today in both kitsch and high culture mediums. Now, who am I and why do I care so much about what is mostly a set of fringe anthropological theories about an ethnic group of less than 15 million people, which most of whom genuinely don't know anything about? Simply put, I'm a Hungarian American who's just interested in this stuff. I think it's under-researched and spent this year living in Budapest, strengthening my knowledge of the language and visiting important locations relevant to this history, and documenting my research into it and other aspects of Hungarian culture on TikTok. Last thing my Hungarian grandfather ever said to me before he died was that the Hungarian and ancient Egyptian languages were related. This is a Turanist idea, and I'd say more on the fringe end of them. I'd known about these outlandish theories beforehand, but if anything really underscored its relevance in my life, it was probably that. My grandfather was a complicated and honestly deeply evil man who made the lives of most everyone he knew worse. He was a peasant of partial Romani descent. As a child during the Holocaust, he helped smuggle goods to Hungarians in transit camps. And as a teen during the anti-communist uprising of 1956, he was a militant and then a refugee. This kind of makes him an archetypical hero in modern Hungary or in the Central and Eastern European countries with similar histories, which is especially funny because he was a criminal who heinously abused basically everyone close to him one way or another and was out of most of his family's lives from long before I was born until I was nearly 20. But with this distant, scary old man haunting my life, I knew growing up that my family came from this weird culture that was from Europe, but also like sort of Asian. At least that's what one of the books that I read kind of said that they were. And I was fascinated, reading everything I could about Hungarian culture and the Huns. And I tried to wrap my head around the language as well. I'm not really interested in psychoanalyzing myself, but everything sort of clicked for me when I understood my relationship with Hungarian history and culture is, in fact, way less characterized by being rooted in it than it is by being alienated from it. So, I don't know, I find it relevant, or at least acceptable, that I tell the story of Hungarian Orientalists because I spent so much of my life orientalizing Hungary itself. Of course, there are people raised in the actual country of Hungary whose mother language is Hungarian and have a much deeper investment and familiarity in the culture than I do. I'm going to cite a lot of those intellectuals, and I hope to have a few of them on for interviews at some point. But a lot of this history, as we'll see, was carried out by Hungarian expats and diasporoids, especially in the late 20th century, many of whom lived in America, Canada, Australia, and elsewhere. So my interest is a little bit of a lifelong passion and infatuation with what I think is a beautiful and unique culture, set of mythologies that have always been sort of orbiting my life, and also a simmering resentment, an attempt to transform my critical distance and alienation into something informative and entertaining. But I promised this podcast would appeal to you even if you don't know the first thing about the country of Hungary, so I should probably let you know what the hell Hungary even is. And if you want a deeper dive into all of this, trust me, it's coming. Hungarians speak what is considered and sometimes mocked as an extremely bizarre and outrageously difficult language. It's impossible, in my opinion, to quantify the objective difficulty of a language. The question will always be to whom. But every time I talk to Hungarians about their famously hard language, they always boast that it's the third hardest language in the world. The first two they mention are usually Arabic and either Chinese or Japanese. I can't tell you objectively how difficult it is because I think such a statement is kind of nonsense, but I can make a speculation as the native English speaker that I am, interested in many languages, who has been practicing Hungarian in both a tutoring and classroom setting for years. If you are an English speaker, it is among the hardest languages you can learn that still uses a Latin alphabet, the same alphabet that English uses, plus a few weird accent marks. This is due to a lot of the un-English-like etymologies of the words and unique pronunciation, but even more so to the staggeringly hard-to-grasp grammar of Hungarian. There is, for example, no fixed word order to the language. When I was first learning it, I heard that and thought, oh, great, that will make the language so easy. I don't have to pay attention to the order of words and can just say stuff however it pops into my head. I was so wrong. This was obviously not true. Because while there is no grammatical word order, there is like a focus position where the most contextually important words to your sentence go in front of the verb. Instead of it being, there's no word order, I don't have to care about it, it's there's actually a third dimension of context ordering that I have to pay attention to. Furthermore, the meaning and functions of words are altered by suffixes that attach themselves to words. So you might have one simple one-syllable word, but depending on the way you use it in a sentence, it can quickly become four, five, six syllables long, basically an entirely new word that the whole meaning of your sentence now depends on. From my experience, the quickest thing to pick up when learning Hungarian is reading, because you can look at a sentence, parse out the individual words and their suffixed meanings, and go back and forth throughout the sentence, piecing it together almost like a puzzle. But when you're listening to someone speak with this grammar and don't have the ability to go back and sort the sentence out, man, it can be pretty hard. This is all important to all these wild ancestry theories, by the way, because if you can understand this podcast, you probably intuitively know most European languages do not do this, but there are many other languages that sort of do. And why don't most European languages do this? Well, virtually all the languages of Europe are considered part of the Indo-European language family. Yes, this includes German, Russian, Spanish, French, Greek, and English. But it also includes Armenian, Kurdish, Persian, and many of the languages of northern India, to name just a few. The Indo-European language family is easily the biggest language family in the world, including approximately 448 languages with over 3.3 billion speakers. Compare this to the second biggest language family in the world, the Sino-Tibetan language family, with approximately 1.5 billion speakers, less than half of Indo-Europeans, and after that, no other language family comes even close. So, despite almost all European language families, plus a lot more, being Indo-European, Hungarian isn't? Yeah, and easily the most mainstream opinion is that it is what would be called a member of the Finno-Ugric language family, with only 24 million speakers. For many of these Hungarian kinship theorists, however, this is the most contentious statement imaginable. I am pretty convinced by the mainstream linguistic theory, but I won't say that I think there may never be a credible discovery that either moves Hungarian out of the Finno-Ugric language family or redefines the Finno-Ugric language family as something else. But people need to understand that if there ever was, it would certainly be one of the most significant linguistic breakthroughs of all time. The Finno-Ugric language family includes Hungarian, of course, but also Finnish, as the name implies, as well as Estonian, spoken in the small Baltic country just to the south of Finland. Other languages in the Finno-Ugric language family include some of the indigenous languages of Russia, such as Khanty, Mansi, Udmurt, and Mari, probably languages you've never heard of if you don't already know about Finno-Ugric languages. And the language family also includes Sami, a people group in the north of Norway, Sweden, Finland, and Russia, known for their beautiful folk costumes and reindeer herding traditions. Maybe the pop culture aspect most people know about Sami from is probably Frozen 2, but it should be worth noting that Hungarian and, let's say, Finnish are related only in the same way that English and Persian, both Indo-European languages, are. Hungary and every other Finno-Ugric language split apart thousands of years ago, experienced their own mutations, have been influenced by countless other languages, making them all almost entirely alien to one another without intense linguistic research. And as a sidebar about linguistic groupings, researching Hungarian Turanism has really shown me how language families and linguistic categories are tied with the social construct of race. You may know that the Indo-European language family used to be called the Aryan or Indo-Aryan language family. Well, Hungarians were theorizing about the existential Oriental racial group they belonged to, often called Turanians. Nationalist theorists in other European countries were also concocting theories about the so-called Aryan race, doing things like bringing North Indian symbolism into a German political context. Name but one example. If you read anything about anthropology from that era, from Nazi race science to Hungarian esoterica to even British imperial intelligence manuals, the Turanian people are often mentioned in the same context as Aryans, and sometimes also the Semites, obviously the Jews. But anyway, how did Hungarians wind up as the only speakers of this unique language family surrounded by almost a continent of Indo-European language speakers? I'll happily answer that because grammar is boring, but medieval conquest is not. So, in prehistoric times, Hungarians, or Magyars as they're called in Hungarian, were in the Ural Mountains, separating Europe from Asia. But eventually, the population moved south into the vast geographic flatlands of the Eurasian steppe. These Hungarians were an equestrian nomadic culture with lifestyles not dissimilar to the Mongols, the Scythians, the ancient Turks, and yes, the Huns that attacked both China, called the Xiongnu, and the Huns of Attila, who attacked Rome. There's a lot of controversy about this. But all of these cultures fought against each other viciously, but they also were infamous amongst their sedentary neighbors for attacking and ravaging non-nomadic settlements. This earned them a reputation for being particularly barbaric, but modern scholarship rejects characterizations like these. These cultures could wage devastating wars, yes, but especially during peace times, many of them had sophisticated social structures, often very tolerant societies, technological innovations that spread across the world, and complex artistic and religious practices that were also adopted by sedentary civilizations. An important note about many of these Eurasian steppe cultures, especially when they got their act together long enough to wage a war against settled states, is that they were often incredibly diverse confederations of many peoples speaking many different languages, though there were abundant cultural similarities and interchange between them. The Eurasian steppe is one of the longest continuous landmasses in the world. It stretches from Manchuria to the north of China, all the way through Mongolia, Kazakhstan, Russia, Ukraine, right up to Hungary. Geographical region of Hungary, called the Pannonian Basin, is a fertile flatland surrounded by the Carpathian Mountains. Think kind of like a bowl. This geography makes it a natural stopping point for any Eurasian nomads who want to travel west and put down roots. Given the centrality of grasslands and the grazing space that many Eurasian nomads needed to survive, this meant an ecological downturn, or just like a lot of dead grass in one part of these flatlands, would create a domino effect of migratory peoples. And historians have noted a lot of these, tracing some of the biggest wars between nomads and settled countries to the ecology of Eurasia and its abundance of grass. In the context of the convenient steppe fortress that is Hungary, the history of the Pannonian Basin, as the region is also called, until the Hungarians arrived, was one of continuous Eurasian horse lords invading, conquering, becoming settled, and then getting invaded by the next Eurasian horse lords to do so. This included the Scythians, Attila's Huns, the Avar cognate, but what makes the Hungarians unique is that they were the last of these invading nomads to do so and stay there now more than 1,000 years. When they first arrived in 895 or 896, Hungarians, or Magyars, were warlike pagans who practiced what's likely a similar religion to the same one that Genghis Khan did. And upon their arrival, they used the Pannonian Basin as a headquarters from which to launch campaigns all across Europe, looting and plundering as far as Spain and the Netherlands. They were ultimately defeated by the Frankish king Otto the Great. It's one of the reasons why they called him the Great. And as a consequence, the Hungarians stayed put in Hungary and developed their country there. The Hungarian king István introduced Christianity as the state religion in the year 1000, and a few pagan uprisings later, the Hungarian kingdom was assimilated into the rest of European Christendom. Hungary's placement on the tip of the Eurasian steppe made them very vulnerable to other nomadic Eurasian invaders. They fought back the nomadic Turkic Cumans, and after suffering a devastating initial defeat, fought back the Mongols as well. This constant warring frequently depleted the population, however, so the Kingdom of Hungary regularly relocated, sometimes by force, sometimes by incentive, other peoples to the emptied-out locations in Hungary. Ultimately, the descendants of the original Hungarian conquerors from Central Asia died in battle or were erased from the gene pool for the most part. And today, other than in a few isolated areas, Hungarians are genetically identical to their surrounding countries. These people were Magyarized, or made to speak Hungarian and otherwise be Hungarian over generations. But prior to their relocation, these populations would come from Slavic backgrounds, sometimes Romanian, sometimes German settlers invited in by the kingdom, and sometimes other steppe nomads like those Cumans that I mentioned who had agreed to convert to Christianity. Even as Hungary Europeanized, with only about 1,000 years of history in Europe, the Hungarians' unique origins as nomadic Eurasian steppe peoples weighed heavily on them since their earliest of days. It doesn't help that the Hungarians' language, with its wildly different grammar and lexicon, played a role in separating the Hungarian identity and society from other European languages. And as European concepts of nationhood or even movements like Pan-Slavism or Pan-Germanism, very much rooted in language, would eventually arise, this linguistic and ethnic distinction would influence the unique characteristics of Hungarian nationalism. Take, for example, this fact. Even today, Hungarians are the least likely to speak a foreign language in the entire European Union. Only 37% of them know any foreign language at all. Compare this to a country like Denmark at 94%, or even Hungary's neighbor Slovenia at 92%. And I hope you can imagine just how stacked the deck is against the very survival of the Hungarian culture and language. There's a stereotype that Hungarians can be sort of melancholic and depressed, and politically this manifests as an obsession with horrific defeats, failed revolutions, the loss of territory, and a consistent struggle joining the wrong side of every war. This is, in fact, sometimes poetically called the Turanian curse or the curse of Turàn, and oh, we'll talk about that later. But I'm a Hungary optimist, and I think this is a glass-half-empty way of taking the long view of Hungarian history. Given the extraordinary circumstances of Hungary's unique language and origin, I can't express enough that I think it's a genuine miracle that this culture has survived as long as it has. So, remember all that about Finno-Ugric languages? Well, as you can imagine, contemporary comparative linguistics is a kind of a new subject. People were obsessed with it during the golden age of racial categorization, but it was also a really emergent science. Until only a couple hundred years ago, people didn't have much in the way of linguistic or anthropological scientific methods to go off of, other than and I understand the same language as those people. But many Hungarians, especially the more educated and worldly of them, obviously knew their language was distinct from other European ones. Plus, Hungarians had both oral and recorded history of their arrival from the East. These very early documents will occupy the next few episodes of this podcast. Honestly, long before I probably even bring up the word Turanism again. I mentioned that Hungarians call themselves Magyars, and their country Magyarország sounds nothing like Hungary, right? It's because Hungary is an exonym. Early sources called the Magyars either Avars, who were the nomadic steppe people that preceded them in the region, or Huns, like, you know, Attila, who preceded the Avars and caused the Roman Empire so much pain. Hungarians were also called the Unugurs, or the Ten Tribes, both because they were initially a confederation of ten tribes, and also because there was a different group of Unuguric people that the Hungarians were mistaken for. There is an incredibly contentious debate in Hungary today about what extent can Hungarians claim the lineage of the mysterious Huns of Attila. I'm going to talk a lot more about this in detail in the next episode. In fact, this relationship will follow us throughout this entire series, but I should sum it up a little bit now, too. On the one hand, the Huns of Attila certainly spoke a different language and arrived from the Eurasian steppe long before the Magyar Hungarians did, and they were wiped out as well long beforehand, too. But both of these people came from a similar place, lived a similar lifestyle, and were historically mistaken for each other by outside cultures. The earliest Hungarian chronicles, as well, explore this relationship and attempt to create justifications for it, knowing fully that the timing made absolutely no sense. So even if there is no genetic or linguistic connection between the two, can there sort of be a social, poetic, or cultural connection between them? We'll see in this podcast that this was a question addressed by Hungarian mythologists, evangelists, philosophers, and aristocracy for generations. Not only the question of the Huns, but also the relationship to other nomadic groups such as the Scythians, and with the advent of modern linguistics, dozens of other people groups as well. I'm looking forward to talking about the class aspects of these myths, too, as many of these myths were used to create artificial distinctions between the Hungarian ruling elite and the Hungarian peasantry. This, at times, helped justify one of the most exploitative feudal systems in Europe. I hope you can understand now why the search for Hungarian origins is an enduring one that stretches back to their first several hundred years on the continent. And search for it they did, across some of the most hazardous terrain and unknown, to Europeans at least, lands. The search for ancestry transformed Hungarian politics, which had initially been very wary of the threat of Eastern invaders, into a desperately missionary search for familial cultures. As we track this history, we will track the history of Hungary, from a medieval Christian state seeking to establish itself as just like the rest of the continent, to a stifled and stunted aristocracy. From a vassal subject between two empires to a country with its own imperialist ambitions. From a spited and embittered nation to an irredentist Nazi ally. From an Eastern Bloc satellite to the nostalgic post-communist state in headlines and a perpetual crisis that it is today.
Tonight, for the first time, this is a very special song from Queen to you.
So what is Turin, and why are we exploring it? I'll answer this in this last part of the episode and step a little bit out of space and time, in part because I want to use this podcast to show people things I think are cool, and because I want to show how far-reaching and international these subjects are, despite being based deeply in the microcosm of Hungary. While Turin, the word, has been used in Hungary since the mid-19th century, the term goes back thousands of years to Iranian mythology and a Vestan tradition. To explain this, and later throughout so much of this podcast, I will draw from Balázs Ablonczy's Go East, A History of Hungarian Turanism. And if you want recommended reading on the subject, I can't recommend any text to you more. It'll be a while before I return to that book, but it was one of the most important books I think I've ever read. It's especially informative for when I go over the period wherein capital T Turanism was most at the forefront of Hungarian culture, the build-up to World War I throughout the end of World War II. Historically, there may be a brief mention of Turanians as a tribe as early as the 5th century AD in Zoroastrian hymns. The term takes on the meaning and narrative that made it so important to countless cultures, though, between the 3rd and 7th centuries. At this point, linguists believe Turan referred to the lands beyond Iran, which were inhabited in large part by nomads and shared what can be thought of as a cultural affinity with the vacuous concept of equestrian Eurasian peoples. While the term would later be adopted by other steppe cultures, especially Turkic peoples, to refer to themselves, Turan did not have such a meaning at first. Likely, the word referred to East Iranian or East Iranic cousins of the West Iranian Persians in what's modern Balochistan. These East Iranian peoples were not dissimilar to other nomadic steppe cultures, and I hope while exploring this history, we'll see that while these nomadic steppe cultures were wildly diverse, they also shared profound similarities in lifestyles, religion, and though they may have belonged to separate language families, shared words that have left a lasting impact all the way to today. And when I talk throughout the series about Scythians, one of the nomadic steppe cultures that controlled massive swaths of Eurasia for hundreds of years, know that Scythians are East Iranian, and being Iranian, they speak a language in that great big Indo-European language family I was talking about earlier, linguistic relatives of Persian, but culturally more similar to Eurasian nomads. I'm painting with really broad strokes here. After the conversion of the Persian people to Islam, a history of the people surveying their pre-Islamic myths was commissioned by the poet Ferdowsi around the year 1000 AD. That book, the Persian Book of Kings, is called the Shahnameh, certainly not the first Persian word I'm going to mispronounce, and it's easily the most influential piece of epic poetry in the Persian-speaking world, comparable to the Odyssey or the Iliad. Part of the Shahnameh tells the story of King Feridun, a mythical king, but one who partially reflects Cyrus the Great, the first Achaemenid king of kings, famous in the Bible for freeing the Jewish captives of Babylonia and allowing them to return to their homeland. According to this Book of Kings, Feridun plays a critical role in the rebellion against the monstrous King Zahak, a tyrant who is cursed with two snakes growing from his shoulders that he must satiate with a stew made of human brains every day. After the hero, Feridun defeats Zahak, banishing him to a cave until the end of time, Feridun ascends to the throne. Feridun's rule is a prosperous one, recorded in the Book of Kings as lasting nearly 500 years, where might and virtue increased in the land, and in all his days he did all that which was good. From the Shahnameh, he roamed throughout the kingdom to seek that which was open and that which was hid, and wrong was righted at his hands. With kindness did he curb the sway of evil. Feridun ordered the world like a paradise. He planted the cypress and the rose where the wild herb had sprouted. Now, after many years were passed, there were born to him three sons, whose mother was of the house of Jamshid. And the sons were fair of mien, tall and strong, yet their names were not known to men, for Feridun had not tested their hearts. But when he beheld that they were come to years of strength, he called them about his throne and bade them search out the king of Yemen, who had three daughters, fair as the moon, that they should woo them unto themselves. Now it came about that when Feridun learned that his sons were returning, he went forth to meet them and prove their hearts. So he took upon him the form of a dragon, that foamed at the mouth with fury and from whose jaws sprang mighty flames. And when his sons were come near unto the mountain path, he came upon them suddenly like a whirlwind and raised a cloud of dust about the place with his writhings, and his roaring filled the air with noise. Then he threw himself upon the eldest born, and the prince laid down his spear and said,
"A wise and prudent man striveth not with the dragons."
And the eldest son turned his back and fled before the monsters, and left him to fall upon his brothers. Then the dragon sprang upon the second, and the second son said,
"Let it be that I must fight. What matter if it be furious lion or a knight full of valor?"
So the second son took his bow and stretched it. The youngest son came towards him, and seeing the dragon, said,
"Thou reptile, flee from our presence, and strut not in the path of lions, for if thou hast heard the name Fedidun, beware of how you do this, for we are his sons, armed with spears and ready for the fight. Quit, therefore, I counsel thee, thine evil path, lest I plant upon thy head the crown of enmity."
Then the glorious Fedidun, when he had thus made trial of their hearts, vanished from sight. And after the clashing of cymbals and braying of trumpets and sounds of rejoicing, said unto them,
"Oh, my sons, listen unto the words that I shall speak. The raging dragon, whose breath was danger, was but your father, who sought to test your hearts, and having learned them, gave way with joy. But now I will give to you such names that are fit. Firstborn shall be called Selim. May thy desires be accomplished in the world, for thou sought to have thyself saved from the clutches of the dragon, nor didst thou hesitate in the hour of flight. A man who fleeth neither before the elephant nor the lion, call him rather foolhardy than brave. And the second, who from the beginning showed his courage, which was ardent as a flame, I will call him Turàn the courageous, who even a mad elephant cannot daunt. The youngest is a man prudent and brave. He knoweth both how to haste and how to tarry. He chose the midway between the flame and the ground, as it beseemeth man of counsel, and he hath proven himself brave, prudent, and bold. Irij he shall be called. Gate of power may be his goal, for the first did show his gentleness, but his bravery sprang forth at the hour of danger."
When Fedidun thus opened his lips, he called for the book wherein are written the stars. Then, having read the secrets of fate, Fedidun parted the world and gave the three parts unto his sons. The lands of Rum, or Anatolia, which are the lands of the setting sun, he did give to Selim. Turin, or Turkestan, did he give to Tur, and made him the master of the Turks and of China. But unto Arij he gave Iran, the throne of might and the crown of supremacy. But as Fedidun's life waned, the evil passions of his sons waxed stronger. The heart of Selim was changed. His desires turned towards evil. His soul also was steeped in greed. Selim bade a messenger mount him upon a dromedary swift of foot and bear this saying unto Tur.
"O King of Turan, thy brother greeteth thee, and may thy days be long in the land. Tell unto me, I pray thee, for thou hast might and wisdom, should we remain ever thus unsatisfied? For surely unto us, not unto Iri, pertaineth the throne of Iran. But now is our brother set above our heads, and should we not strive against the injustice of our father?"
Now, when Tur had listened to these words, his head was filled with wind, and he spake unto the messenger and said,
"Say unto your master, O my brother, full of courage, since our father deceived us when we were young and void of guile, with his own hands hath he planted a tree whence must issue fruit of blood and leaves that are poison.
Now the two older brethren went forth unto the tents of Erij, and Erij would have greeted them. They suffered him not, but straightway began to question him and heap reproaches upon his head. And Tur said,
Why hast thou uplifted thyself above us? And is it met that thy elders bow down before thee?
When Erij heard these words, he answered,
Oh, kings greedy of power, I say unto you, if ye desire happiness, strive for peace. Covet neither the royal crown nor the hosts of Iran. Power that endeth in discord is an honor that leadeth to tears. And I will step down from the throne of Iran if it shall foster peace between us, for I crave not the possession of the world if ye are attracted by the sight. For I am humble of heart, and my faith bids me to be kind.
Now Tur had heard these words. They softened not his spirit, and he knew only that which is evil, and wist not that Erij spoke truly. And he took up the chair whereon he sat, and threw it at his brother in his anger. Then Erij called for mercy at his hands, saying,
O king, hast thou no fear of God, no pity for thy father? Pray thee, destroy me not, lest God ask vengeance for my blood. Let it not be spoken that thou who hast life taketh that gift from others. Do not this evil. Crush not even the tiny ant that beareth a grain of corn, for she hath life, and sweet life is a boon. I will vanish from thy sight. I will live in solitude and secrecy, so that I may yet behold the sun.
But these words angered Tur only more. And he drew from his boot a dagger that was poisoned and sharp, and he thrust it into the breath of Erij, the kingly cedar. Young lord of the world paled, and he was dead. Then Tur cut the head from the trunk and filled it with musk and ambergris, and sent it unto the old man his father, who had parted the world, saying,
Behold the head of thy darling. Give unto him now the crown and the throne.
Thus mourned Feridun, and the voice of lamentation was abroad. Then it came about that after many years had passed, Feridun bethought him of a daughter of Erij. And there was born unto them a son fair and strong, worthy of the throne, named Minichir. And when he was yet but a tender babe, they brought him to Feridun and cried,
O Lord of the earth, let thy soul rejoice. Behold this Erij!
The tidings of splendor that surrounded Feridun pierced even into the lands of Rum and of China, and the kings thereof were troubled and downcast in their hearts. Then they conferred how they should regain the favor of the Shah, for they feared Minichir when he should become old enough unto years of might. So they sent a messenger unto Feridun, bearing rich gifts, and bade him speak unto their father and say,
O Shah, live forever.
I bear a message from the humblest of thy slaves, who are bowed unto the earth with contrition, wherefore they have not ventured into thy presence. And they pray that thou pardon their evil deed, for their hearts are good, and they did it not of themselves, but because it was written that they should do this wrong, and that which is written in the stars, surely it is accomplished. Now, when Feridun had listened to these words of his sons, he knitted his brows in anger, and he said unto the messenger,
Go say unto your masters that their false hearted words shall avail them of nothing, and ask them if they be not shamed to utter white words with tongues of blackness. I have heard their messages. Hear now the answer that I send, and say unto me that ye desire the love of Minichir. I ask of you, what did ye for Erij? Now that ye are delivered of him, ye seek the blood of his son?
Verily I say unto you, never shall ye look upon his face, save when he leadeth a mighty army.
The kings, when they had heard this, and the message of their father, trembled for fear. And Tur said unto Selim,
henceforth we must forego pleasure, for it behoveth us to hasten and not tarry till the teeth of this young lion be sharpened and he be waxed tall and strong.
Then they made ready their armies, and the number of their men was past the counting. Helmet was joined to helmet, and spear to spear, and jewels, baggage, and elephants without number went with them. You would have said it was a host that none could understand, and they marched from Turin to Iran. And the two kings rode before them, their hearts filled with hate, but the star of these evil ones was sinking. Now, Tur and Selim, when they saw that the Iranians were come out against them, set in order their army. And when the day had torn asunder the folds of night, the two armies met in battle, and the fight waged strong until the setting of the sun, and the earth was like a sea of blood, and the feet of the elephants were like pillars of coral. And when the sun was sunk to his rest, Tur and Selim consulted how they might seize upon Minichir by fraud, for they saw that his arm was strong and his courage undaunted. So Tur set forth at the head of a much smaller band to surprise him in his tents. But Minichir was aware of these evil plans and sprang upon him. And when Tur would have fled, Minichir followed him and struck a lance into his back. And when he had killed him, he cut his head from his trunk, and the body did give unto the wild beasts. This narrative is one of the first meaningful instances of the concept of Turin and an attempt to explain its origins. Throughout Persian literature for generations to come, the dichotomy between the settled lands of Iran and the tumultuous, nomadic steppe of Turin would remain an important theme, and it became an appealing framework even outside of Iran, because the tension between nomadic and settled peoples was one that most of the cultures on the periphery of the steppe would have experienced. What I like about the use of the term Turin in Persian literature, too, is how sort of amorphous its meaning is. It's sort of pinned down to the actual location of a particular place, the steppes in the direction of Turkestan and even China, but it's also a reference to a type of environment and therefore a type of people. Over time, this word would become a symbol of the Turkic world, even rising to prominence as an actual Turkic state, though it originally referred more so to East Iranian peoples to the north of Iran. Turin itself later became a country when Tamerlane established the state that he called Turin in Samarkand. But I think the concept of Turin and its use in the literal founding mythology of a settled state is really interesting, too. Turin became more and more a self-aware identity and political affinity as the Turanian people, so to speak, became gradually more assimilated into settled societies. After all, pan-Turanism, as we'll eventually see, was a modern movement across many cultures that took hold when the nomadic history of most of the cultures it applied to was in the distant past. Few of these people assimilated more heavily than the Hungarians. And that's why, while I find the development of Turanism fascinating in the many countries that it emerged in, believe me, we'll investigate those in this project too, I think the Hungarian mutation of the ideology, with its shoehorning of Christianity and European political alliances, is such a totally interesting example of it. But there's nearly 1,000 years of history between then and now. Next episode, we'll explore the first document recording the Hungarians, written about 300 years after their arrival in Europe, but no, it's not really a history, and is more so a hazy anthology of myths, really not dissimilar to the Persian Book of Kings. It's not exactly starting at the beginning of the story of Hungary, because this document, called the Gesta Hungarum by an anonymous guy named Anonymous, was already so distant as to have mythologies informing its very beginning, and I think it's a good place to start because of it. While the modern Hungarian Turanist often has to invent genetic or linguistic conspiracies and do semantic acrobats to explain his Asian identity, these medieval Hungarians were really just a few generations removed from their steppe roots, some of them at least. But they had already concocted fantastic legends to explain their past. Finally, feel free to follow me on TikTok, Twitter, and Instagram, and I've got a YouTube, too, that I should post these on as well. I'm going to tweak a lot about this podcast as I go along. Sorry for any rough bumps at this beginning, but I'm really excited to be making it, and I've got a ton of stuff that I want to tell you about. I've also got a Patreon. I want this podcast to be free, at least for now, but if you want to support this or any future Turan Explorer projects, feel free to kick us something. So anyway, I'll see you next time in Turan.